While we can check our hotend's rough performance using max flow rate methods, those will never tell us how well hotends melt the filament and how good the layer adhesion will be. To test that properly, I broke over 1000 samples with a tensile strength testing machine in my previous video and determined that printing at around half of your true max flow rate still gives good layer adhesion. But what about testing more hotends? What about just increasing the printing temperature? Or what about nozzle designs that split the filament flow to heat it faster? Well, my new layer adhesion testing data are quite revealing and in some cases even shocking. So let's find out more. I tested the stock Bambu lab hotend with a hardened steel tip, the DZ 3.0 using a hardened steel nozzle with a copper insert, and the high flow obsidian that E3D sent to check out. All of them were tested on the Bambu lab P1S with a stock heater and thermistor to get an apples to apples comparison. To test the layer adhesion, I have a custom test print where I print the middle section of it at different flow rates, cut it in 20 pieces for each rate and break them on my tensile strength testing machine. This time I also will be printing additional samples in a vertical orientation to determine the strength of a material and how much we're losing by adding it layer by layer. But before I could do that, I need to make a few upgrades to my testing machine, as previously it really didn't like high loads and flex quite a bit. So I bought another aluminum extrusion, printed parts from a very stiff Bambu PET carbon fiber filament, and bolted extrusions together. Even though my original test specimen holders were from nylon filled with carbon fiber, I really didn't want them bending and starting to impact the accuracy of the results. This is where, yet again, today's video sponsor PCBWay greatly contributed by machining these amazing holders from extremely stiff and durable tool steel material. If you need any professionally manufactured parts like these, make sure to check them out as they have been an incredible contributors to making these testing videos possible. So with all this out of the way, let's dive straight into the results. For all my testing, I use Bambu Basic PLA of purple color. Based on the previous results, it represents quite well how layer adhesion drops at higher flow rates with the most filaments. The stock Bambu lab hotend when printing at 220 degrees performed, well, very unimpressive to say the least. The layer adhesion dropped very fast with higher flow rates and speeds. Upping the temperatures to 240 degrees made a significant difference by boosting layer adhesion even when printing slowly. Now we can reach up to 200 mm per second printing speeds at regular settings with almost no loss in layer adhesion. But as probably most of you expected, those results come nowhere even close to what E4D High Flow hotend can reach with fast HT type of design, where we split the filament flow into multiple sections to get more surface area to heat it faster. It completely blows away the stock hotend's performance. However, this is where I spotted the strange effect of the adhesion curve starting to flatten. The only way I can explain this is that the extruded plastic has way less time to cool down at higher speeds and we're reaching a better bond. Without this effect, the results would probably look something like this, with a steeper drop-off. This is the only reason I kept all my testing to 30 cubic millimeters per second. Meanwhile, when printing at 240 degrees, the layer adhesion curve of the E4D hotend looks almost like a perfectly flat line. Again, it would probably drop off more, but even then, its ability to properly melt the filament is completely ridiculous. Their claim of 60% flow rate improvement is spot on, but yet again, the flow rate doesn't tell the whole story. To show that, I made this graph. While with a stock Bambu lab hotend at 15 cubic millimeters per second flow rate we can get only around 3% under extrusion, the layer adhesion drops at a 10 times faster rate and we end up losing 35% of the original strength. Meanwhile, with a high flow obsidian hotend we can literally print twice the speed and flow rate while maintaining comparable layer adhesion. I feel like E4D is doing themselves a huge disservice by not measuring the actual adhesion, because this is where this hotend truly shines. And that price tag of 75 bucks before shipping and taxes sounds so much more reasonable. But what about a way cheaper TZ 3.0 hotend? I tested it with a hardened steel nozzle that had a copper insert. I even applied boron nitride paste to get the best case scenario. However, the results completely shocked me. Its layer adhesion was barely higher at 240 degrees compared to the stock Bambu Labs hotend at 220 degrees. I even ran into an issue where at 25 cubic millimeter per second flow rate the stock heater couldn't provide enough power, printing at 4 degrees lower temperature. I changed the stock heater with the included 60 watt one, which fixed the temperature problem, but the adhesion results were identical at only 12 megapascals. My first guess was that the P1S heating fan was too powerful for this hotend design and it cooled so much that the active melt zone decreased. This got me worried even about the TZ 2.0 hotends as I ran them on multiple printers. So I did more layer adhesion tests and the results were again shocking. I made this easy to follow chart. It seems when you actually test how well layers bond, those copper inserts in a hardened steel nozzle seems quite a bad idea. The only nozzle that improved layer adhesion was the nickel plated copper with the insert. Finally, I printed some samples in a vertical orientation to test the purple PLA material strength. When calculated, all samples consistently end up at around 67 MPa. Adding all values when printed at 5 cubic millimeter per second flow rates gives us a pretty nice overview. Turns out we're still maintaining around 60% of the material strength by adding it layer by layer, which I would say is still pretty decent result. From all this testing, the only thing that kept bothering me was the different thermistor location, as I had no testing data on how this affects the heater's temperature. So out of curiosity, I sacrificed one of my TZ 2.0 hotends by drilling some slots and adding a few thermocouples smeared in high thermal conductivity boron nitride paste. On idle, temperatures were identical, meanwhile there was a small difference when heating or extruding the filament, as it absorbs the heat and the heater must run at higher power. In my testing scenario, probes were not that deep inside the heat block, but I'm pretty sure we would see a higher difference, probably up to 5 degrees if we measured closer to the core at higher flow rates. However, I feel like with E3D hotend, having a thermistor on the other side makes sense, as that ensures that the whole heat block doesn't drop below the set temperature, as we can dump so much more plastic through such a small hotend. Summarizing all the results, the most important part to take away from all this is that if plastic still flows, it doesn't mean it still gives good layer adhesion. In fact, the max flow rates tell us so little about our hotend's true performance that we could argue that it is a misleading testing method. When comparing the stock Bambu Hotend versus E3D High Flow, the advertised 60% boost in flow rate seems so insignificant compared to the wonders that it does to the layer adhesion of our prints. Yes, we can argue that changing the thermistor's location makes the heater run at slightly higher temperatures, but let's be real, it is the improved CHT type of design that gives that insane boost to the layer adhesion at higher flow rates. While increasing the printing temperature can greatly improve the layer adhesion at higher speeds and flow rates, it not only can produce way more all kinds of emissions, but also by printing too hot, you can even start losing adhesion. So at least be aware of that. In my opinion, if we can't properly heat the filament, instead of cranking temperatures, we should rather increase the length of the melt zone or use designs that improve the filament heating rate. But again, be aware that some can be just gimmicks and others can actually do wonders. But maybe you have a different opinion about all this, feel free to share it in the comments below. Huge thanks to all the people who contribute by becoming a patron or YouTube member. Well, that's all from me, and I'll see you next time.